السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف أنبياء الله وخاتم رسله حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين، وعلى الصفوة الخيرة من أصحابه الميامين ومن تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. We are celebrating the anniversary of the birthday of the 8th Imam of the school of Ahlul Bayt, the grandson of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam. Imam al-Ridha is a universal encyclopedia. I will do injustice to him if I try to present him to you in 30 or 40 minutes. However, I'm going to focus only on one aspect of his life. Imam al-Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam lived for 55 years. So his age when he died was only 55 years old. When he received the leadership, the imamah, after the departure of his father, al-Imam Musa al-Kadhim alayhi salam, who died in the prison in Baghdad, after 11 years, Imam al-Kadhim died in the prison. Imam al-Ridha was 35 years old, so he assumed the succession, the khilafah and the imamah to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the political climate at that time was anti-Ahlul Bayt and anti-Shia climate. That time was the time of Harun al-Abbasi. Historians call him al-Rashid. Al-Rashid means mature, but he was not mature. He was immature, actually. But this is history. History, most of the Islamic history, my friends, are written by some people who were hired by the caliph to write the history. They were paid. 99% of the historians were paid either by the Umayyad caliphs or the Abbasid caliphs. So we really cannot trust the history books. You have to do your own homework, your own investigation to find out about the truth, what happened at that time. Harun was the caliph, and then succeeded when Harun died. He appointed three of his children to be his heirs and his successors. One of them is Al-Amin, whose mother was an Arab, and she was related to Harun from Bani al-Abbas, from the same family. And she was very powerful and very influential. Harun, this so-called great caliph, had to listen to her and obey her sometimes. She controlled the caliph. Her name was Zubaydah. She was an Arab and from Bani al-Abbas, related to the caliph. This was one of his wives. He had many maids that filled his palace in Baghdad. Almost 2,000 maids, but not in one place, in different palaces. Then he had another wife who was Persian, and she was a slave She used to work in the kitchen making Persian food for Harun. And there is a story, I don't want to go into the details of the story. Harun was forced to have a relation with this lady, and then she became pregnant with his son Al-Ma'mun. Al-Ma'mun. So the first one was Al-Amin, the second one was Al-Ma'mun. And then Harun had a third wife who was Turkish. So the first one Arab, Persian, and Turkish. And he had his third son in line for succession by the name of Al-Mu'tasim. So the first one who was supposed to come after him was Al-Amin, the second one Al-Ma'mun, the third one Al-Mu'tasim, and the father is Harun. Harun al-Abbasi, big name. If you Google him, there are many volumes that they speak about him and his adventures and his corruption. And Baghdad, at that time, have you heard of this expression, 1,000 nights and one night? Huh? These nights were special nights of entertainment and fun and parties, wild parties in Baghdad under these caliphs, Al-Harun and his children, but mostly during the time of Harun. And Islam expanded militarily, but not morally. Militarily, Islam became powerful, so Islam started to expand eastward and westward. Eastward going as far as beyond India, beyond the Indian subcontinent. It went to China. And then westward, it came to the Atlantic, the shores of the Atlantic and North Africa. And Harun used to become arrogant sometimes, and he would speak to the cloud and says, "Sharqi aw gharbi fa innaki la tamturina illa fi mulki." All clouds, whether you travel far east, sharqi, or far west, gharbi, whenever you drop your rain, that is my territory and my land. But it was only a military expansion, not ethical or moral expansion. It was not based on Islamic teachings. It was based on dominance. Before his death, Harun wrote a will, wasiyya. He said, "After me, my son, first son, Al-Amin, my favorite son from my favorite wife, Zubaydah. After him, my second son, Al-Ma'mun, from my Persian wife. And after Ma'mun, when Ma'mun dies, then my third son, Al-Mu'tasim, becomes the caliph from my Turkish wife." No sooner Harun died, the conflict erupted between the children. When the father is not ethical and not religious, and he's not working for Islam, he's working for the dunya, definitely there will be disagreement among his children. There were people around Amin and Ma'mun. Each one had his own gang surrounding them, from their own tribe, from their own mother's side. Al-Amin was surrounded by Arabs. Ma'mun was surrounded by people from Khurasan, because his mother was from Khurasan. Mu'tasim was surrounded by people who were from Turkey and Turkish race. So they came to Amin and Ma'mun, and they said to Al-Ma'mun, "Why do you respect your brother? Who's your brother? You are more talented than him." Al-Ma'mun was in Khurasan at that time, and he was supposed to be the crown prince, Waliul Ahd, the heir to the throne after his brother. Amin was in Baghdad. So they said to him, "Listen, your brother is very weak, he's corrupt, he's not qualified to be the caliph. You are more qualified than him." So they, you know, the friends and those, the private circles and the advisors, they provoked both brothers against each other until One day Al-Amin was very angry and he said, my brother Al-Ma'mun is no longer Waliyul Ahd, and he appointed his own son by the name of Musa. The son, Musa, the son of Al-Amin. The news reached Khorasan. Takes a few days. There was no WhatsApp at that time, you know. So it takes 2 or 3 weeks for the news to reach Khorasan. As soon as the Ma'mun heard about this, he was in Tus, in Khorasan. He said then, Al-Amin is not the caliph. I declare myself, not only I am not the crown prince, now I am Amir al-Mu'mineen and the caliph of the Muslim Ummah. Al-Amin sent an army to meet with his brother. His brother Al-Ma'mun in Khorasan again mobilized another army to confront his brother. And these two armies, one of them coming from Iraq, Baghdad, the other coming from Khorasan, they met somewhere in the middle in the city of Ray, which is Tehran. Today's Tehran, the capital of Iran. They met there. And there was a fierce battle between two Muslim armies. One representing Daesh, ISIS, one representing Al-Qaeda. Both of them are terrorists, and both of them are corrupt. In that battle in Iran, in Ray, Tehran, hundreds of thousands of soldiers perished from both sides. But then the army of Al-Amin, the older brother, the caliph, was crushed by his brother, the army of his brother, Al-Ma'mun. Al-Ma'mun said, this is not an enough victory for me. I have to proceed and go and capture my brother himself in Baghdad. So he sent the same army from Tehran. They marched through the plains and the mountains and the rivers until they reached Baghdad. And Baghdad was under siege for 1.5 years, 18 months, by the Khorasani army, the army of Al-Ma'mun who came from Khorasan. During this period of siege, Al-Amin tried to negotiate with his brother, tell him, I'm sorry, you know, I was foolish, I didn't mean to dispose you and remove you, so I apologize to you, please spare my life. Ma'mun said no. He ordered his commander, you know, of the army, the commander-in-chief of his army, that, listen, I want you to bring me my brother handcuffed. Handcuffed, bring him back to me to Khorasan. And during these 18 months, there were poverty, starvation in Baghdad, even plagues in the city, diseases, people died in thousands. There were no food allowed, no medicine allowed into the city. It was a big disaster. At the end, while one day Al-Amin, His Majesty, the King, his subjects are dying in Baghdad in thousands, he was busy fishing. Fishing. There is a river goes by Baghdad, Tigris River, Dijla. So he was sitting there enjoying fishing. All of a sudden he saw the army of Al-Ma'mun, his brother, bursting into his castle. They captured him and they beheaded him. They cut his head as ISIS do today with the American journalists and with other peoples. So you know where Daesh and ISIS, they come from. Now you know. They follow the Bani Umayyah and Bani Abbas. This is not something new in the history of Islam. Because some people say, wow, where is this in Islam? We have not seen in Islam someone, well, they cut the head of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. They cut his head and they carried his head from one city into another city, proud. They were proud that this is the head of a Kharijite, a seceder, who revolted against the legitimate caliph Yazid ibn Muawiyah, and he deserves death. This is exactly, my friends, there is a criminal by the name of Ibn Taymiyyah, the most wicked person God created on earth. And now there are millions of Wahhabis and Salafis, they consider him to be the leader of Islam, Shaykh al-Islam. They follow him. He has written a book, 4 volumes. I have them. 4 volumes. Minhaj al-Sunnah. This book has to be read by every Wahhabi. He does not graduate until he memorizes these 4 volumes. He dedicates this book from cover to cover, 4 volumes, to curse and slander Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. In one sentence, he says, any Sahabi that you put your hand on him, any Sahabi, any companion of the Prophet is better than Ali ibn Abi Talib. Someone who's really sick. Someone, the Quran says, sometimes you wonder, do we really have such sick people? Yes, the Quran says this. The story of Moses and Aaron. When Moses came from the mountain and he saw his community, Bani Israel, worshipping the calf, al-ajl, the calf. He burned this calf, he burned it. He said, your Lord, I'm going to burn him. So he burned him, and then he threw him into the Red Sea. The ashes of the calf were thrown and dumped into the Red Sea. Some of those worshippers of Bani Israel, the people of Musa, people who were with Musa, around Musa, the companions of Musa, the Sahaba of Musa, they threw themselves into the sea, and they started drinking that holy water. This is in the Quran. This is in the Quran here. This is not a fairy tale. أُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهُمُ الْعِجْلِ, Allah says. This is how they loved to worship the calf other than God. Shirk, an act of shirk. So don't tell me we have no sick people. We have a plenty of them. Some people, they hate Ali ibn Abi Talib. They can't stand to hear his name, Ali. They can hear any name but Ali. One of them is Ibn Taymiyyah, Ahmed Ibn Abdul Halim Ibn Taymiyyah, who lived 700 years ago. And even many Muslims of his time, they rejected him and his teachings. They said, this man is radical, is heretic. He insults our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they took the head of Al-Amin to his brother Ma'mun, and Ma'mun, then he transferred the Asima, the capital, the paitakht of Islam, from Khorasan, he came to Baghdad after killing his brother. He came to Baghdad. Then there is a huge unrest, a resentment against Al-Ma'mun by his family, by Bani Abbas. They said to him, what did you do? You killed your own brother? This is the way you killed him? Not only he killed him, when they took the head of the Amin to Khorasan, his brother Al-Ma'mun, he said, you have to put his head here at the entrance of the palace. And then he will give money to some people to curse him from morning till evening. He gives money, they stand, people stand and they curse Amin. They curse the Amin. Until one day something happened, Ma'mun said, don't curse him anymore. Someone came to Amin to curse him, he got money. And he said, I curse you and I curse your father and your mother and your whole family. Ma'mun said, no, don't curse his father. His father is my father, you know. Don't curse him. Only curse him. From that day, he said, bring his head back. And he said, send it to Baghdad to be buried with his body in Baghdad. Many of the people of Bani al-Abbas, most of them were corrupt and tyrant. They revolted against Al-Ma'mun. They said to him, what did you do? If you have a disagreement with your brother, you should not kill him. Put him in jail, but not kill him, not to cut his head. This is why Al-Ma'mun, he saw himself living in danger. His own people, they don't like him. His own clan, they are not loyal to him. So he was thinking of how to win the hearts of people, how to do some restitution to this damage that he did. Al-Ma'mun was very smart, very intelligent, extremely intelligent. So he said the best thing to win the hearts of the Abbasite, my family, and all the Muslims, is to use Imam Ridha. Imam Ridha alayhi salam is here. Bring him, make him Waliul Ahd, make him the crown prince. Not only that, but he also started to declare publicly in all his sessions that he had that I am the Shia of Ahlul Bayt. I am the follower of Ahlul Bayt. And then he brought some scholars and he said to them, from now on, I do not want to hear the name of Muawiyah. Nobody mentions Muawiyah in goodness. Nobody says Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman are better than Ali ibn Abi Talib. And then he had sessions, debates, scholarly debates with the leaders of Sunnism in Baghdad, not only Baghdad, all other capitals of Islam, Cairo, Damascus, from Iran, from North Africa. He would bring the scholars to have a debate with them and prove to them that Ali ibn Abi Talib should be the first caliph after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ma'mun, although was very cunning person, deceiving person, but he was intelligent and he was learned. He studied. So he had some knowledge. So he pretended that he's Shia. And he gives preference to Ali ibn Abi Talib over others. And he stands with Imam Ali. More than that, he did something practical. You know the land of Fadak? Land of Fadak is a land, if you travel north of Medina, that land, Allah said, Allah gave it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah gave it to the Prophet. He said, this is a private property for you. This does not belong to the Muslims. This is a personal gift from God to you. You use it. It was an agricultural land which had a huge revenue at that time, huge revenue. And Allah gave it to the Prophet. The Prophet, during his lifetime, gave this, the ownership of this land to whom? To his daughter Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. But immediately, few hours after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they took this land from Fatima al-Zahra. They sent soldiers north of Medina. They kicked out all those farmers and the employees who used to work in that land. They kicked them out and they brought new ones and they said, you have nothing to do with this land. They took it away from Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. Then it went back to Ahlul Bayt during the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Umayyad king, whose rule lasted for 2 years, from 99 Hijri until 101 Hijri. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Arabs, the Sunnis, they call him Al-Khalifatul Adil, the just ruler. You know why they call him the just ruler? Because Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan declared that in every Friday prayers, every khatib, every speaker, every imam who gives the Friday sermon, at the end has to conclude his sermon with cursing Ali and Fatima and Hassan and Hussein. Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. He cannot leave the pulpit unless he concludes his speech by cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib. And people of dunya, people follow the dunya. An-nasu abidu dunya. Imam Hussein has a beautiful description. He says, an-nas, people mostly, with a few exceptions, mostly abidu dunya. They are enslaved to the dunya. Whoever gives more, they run after him. So the khatibs and the imams, they work for the government from that day until now. If you go to some countries, many countries, and you speak to the imam and tell him, don't you know that this is the truth and this is false? He says, yes, I know, but I can't say it in public. I lose my job. I lose my job because they lose their job. Their jobs and the income is more important than the akhirah. This is why Muslims are going backward. Other nations are going forward. Only Muslims are going backward. Because Muslims only read the Quran, but they don't practice it. They face the Kaaba 5 times a day, but they don't practice what they do. They don't speak the truth. They look for their own interests, narrow interests. This is why today the Muslim world is divided, is it bleeding? Tell me which Muslim country today, look at the map, look at the Muslim countries, which one is not being wounded and bleeding now? Almost all of them. Almost. Because they don't speak the truth. And the Prophet said about Imam Ali, Allahumma ansur man nasara wakhdhul man khadar. The one who stands with him, support him, give him victory. And the one who turns against him, ukhdhul, destroy him. Don't let them score any victory. So Al-Ma'mun came. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was the one who said no more cursing of Ali ibn Abi Talib when he came to power in year 99 Hijri. Imagine Imam Ali died what year? Do you know what year? 40 Hijri. From 40 until 99, how many years? 59 years. Almost 60 years they were cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib. 60 years. Cursing him in the masjid, not in the nightclub, not in the street, in the masjid. They had to curse Ali ibn Abi Talib. When Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came, he said, no more cursing of this man. No more cursing of him. This man is the builder of Islam. He's the champion of Islam. He's the pioneer of Islam. We curse him? So he stopped cursing him. He gave an order to the entire Islamic countries and provinces. From now on, instead of cursing Ali, you read this verse, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. You hear this verse in Salatul Jum'ah? Our brothers, they read it. This is from the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Before that, this sentence was cursing of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Instead of this sentence. Then came Ma'mun, who feared for his seat of the Khilafat. He did not fear for Ahlul Bayt. He did not have sympathy with Ahlul Bayt. Neither he believed in them. But he was about to lose his seat and his leadership and his Khilafah. So he pretended that he's a pro Ahlul Bayt. So he gave back the land of Fadak to the Alawites, to the descendants of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Fatima al-Zahra. So he can suppress the people. There were many revolutions against him, against al-Ma'mun, all over the Muslim countries, including Iraq, Khorasan, Basra, Kufa, Egypt, Sham, Syria, Yemen, Hijaz. So he said the best thing to fool the people first, and to tell them that I'm an advocate of Ahlul Bayt. Listen. And he knows that people deep in their hearts, they love Ahlul Bayt. He knows. So he decided to ask Imam al-Ridha to come all the way from Medina, come all the way to Khorasan, to accept this post, being the heir to the throne. Imam said to him, no, I'm not going to accept that. I'm not looking for khilafah and leadership, political position. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed us to be the teachers, the mentors, the guide to the people. This is not my inspiration. This is not my aspiration. I don't want to be caliph. He threatened Imam alayhi salam with death. He said to him, listen, you have no choice. Your father died in the prison. Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam. Your father died in the prison of my father, Harun, in Baghdad. And you have no choice, either to come or accept or you face death. And our imams, unfortunately, they did not have enough followers to stand with them. Many people, they were loyal with Ahlul Bayt only with their tongues and mouths, not with their arms and hands. They say we love Ahlul Bayt. When it comes to serious business, where they should stay with Ahlul Bayt, they leave them alone and they run away. This is exactly what they did with Imam Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. So he put a pressure on Imam alayhi salam to accept Wilayatul Ahd. And we will speak about that at the end, inshallah. But what I want to also focus on is the leadership of the Imam. At that time, the pro-Shia were a lot. They were increasing in numbers, even within the government and the military. And the military. One of the reasons that the Al-Ma'mun al-Abbasi, he wanted the Imam to be Waliyul Ahd, because many military commanders were Shia, were loyal to Ahlul Bayt. And he feared the coup d'etat against him. So he wanted to appease them and tell them, listen, after me is going to be this man that you love. So he forces the Imam to accept Wilayatul Ahd through intimidation, through threats. Imam resisted to the point that he could not resist anymore, either death or the acceptance of Wilayatul Ahd. So the Imam left Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara in a caravan with his family. Now the Imam is 52 years old. This is the 3 years after, before his death, before his Shahada, martyrdom. And he went, if you look at the map, from Medina you have to go through where? Through Iraq. And then from Iraq, where do you go? Through Iran. You go through Ahwaz, and then north, and then Shahr al-Ray, and then until you reach Tus. Wherever the caravan of the Imam reaches, the people of that city, they all come out of their homes in reception of this Imam. The news spreading that the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha, is passing through their city and their villages. They would come, the scholars would come, ask him questions, and the Imam would answer. Listen to one of his adversaries, someone who does not like the Imam, but sometimes even enemies, sometimes they speak the truth. His name is Ibrahim ibn al-Abbas. He says, مَا رَأَيْتُ الرِّضَى سُئِلَ عَنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا عَلِيمَهُ. I never saw Imam Ridha when he was asked about something, but he has an answer to it. إِلَّا عَلِيمَهُ. وَلَا رَأَيْتُ أَعْلَمَ مِنْهِ. In my life, I never experienced something more knowledgeable than him. وَكَانَ الْمَأْمُونَ. The Caliph, Al-Ma'mun, يَمْتَحِنُهُ. He would test him. بِالسُّؤَالِ عَنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. He would ask him about every science. Anything that comes to the mind of the Caliph, he would ask the Imam. And وَكَانَ فَيُجِيبُ عَنْهُ. And the Imam has an answer for that. وَكَانَ كُلُّ. This is interesting. Every speech, every answer the Imam gave, كَانَ جَوَابُهُ وَكَلَامُهُ انْتِزَاعًا مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ الْكَرِيمِ. Extraction from the Qur'an. He never answered anything but from this book. He extracts the answer, he takes it out from this book, and he gave it to the Khalifa. The answer from the Qur'an. This is why the Prophet, before his death, he said, O Muslims, my Ummah, I am leaving behind you الثقلين, two weighty things. كتاب الله وعترتي أهل بيت. Those who teach you the book are my family. Don't get it from anywhere, any source. They have been designated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach you the knowledge of this book. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. When you want to know something, go to أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ. And أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ are محمد وآل محمد عليهم الصلاة والسلام. So eventually, long story to cut it short, Imam accepted Wilayatul Ahd. He arrived into Khorasan, Tuz, and there was a huge reception for the Imam. But the biggest debate Imam had in the city of Naysabur, or today they call it Naishabur, but the ancient name is Naysabur. And this city produced many scholars, many, many transmitters of hadith and exegists of the Quran, and many scientists and many theologians. They gathered around the Imam and they said to him, Yabna Rasulullah. Many scholars, they gathered around the Imam and they said to him, tell us a hadith that you heard this hadith from the Prophet through your forefathers. The Prophet said, Sami'tu Abi, I heard my father, Imam Musa al-Ja'far. And he heard his father, Imam al-Sadiq, from his father, Imam al-Baqir, from his father, Imam Zain al-Abidin, from his father, Imam al-Husayn, from his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen, from Rasulullah, from Jibreel, anillahi ta'ala. What is the hadith? This hadith has been known as the golden chain hadith, golden chain. Because the chain of narrators are all imams, ma'asums. There is no stranger in the middle. All of them are ma'asum. Golden, golden chain. You cannot find a powerful, more powerful chain of narrators than this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qal, لا إله إلا الله حسني فمن دخل حسني أمن من عذاب. كلمة لا إله إلا الله, كلمة التوحيد, the monotheism is my fortress. Once you enter into my fortress, you are completely protected against punishment, against any hurt. Then he moved a couple of steps and he said again, بِشَرْطِهَا وَشُرُوطِهَا وَأَنَا مِنْ شُرُوطِهَا. But not only to say La ilaha illallah and do nothing. It has shuroot, it has conditions and requirements, and one of them is the imamah, not only tawheed or nubuwa, to believe in the imamah, and I am one of the imams. Imam Ali ibn Musa Rida said this on his way to Khorasan. He went to Khorasan. There was a huge reception for him. The entire province of Khorasan, which at that time was the capital of Islam, the capital of Islam, the seat of the caliphate at that time, they came to receive the Imam and celebrate his arrival into that land. Ma'mun was in the forefront. He showed a great deal of respect to the Imam, but he had a plan in his mind. He did not like the Imam. He had a plan. He wanted the Imam to support him and to support his rule and his government. And the Imam, he knew about this. Our Imams, they know. Again, the Imam refused. He said to him, "I'fini, leave me alone. I'm not here to assume leadership." He said, "La budda laka min dhalik. You have no choice. I brought you here with no choice. You have to accept this." And then he said, the best thing, I brought Ali ibn Musa Rida here, and now people are okay, they are not revolting against me. Now it's time to defeat Ali ibn Musa Rida. How does he want to defeat the Imam? He said, I will gather all the leaders of all religions, the top Jewish leader in the Muslim world, the top Christian, Sabian, Zoroastrian, even the atheist, all the theologians, philosophers, leaders of sects, denominations, religions. He said, bring them to Khorasan. I want them to debate with علي بن موسى الرضا عليه السلام. And his intention was for the Imam to be defeated. When the Imam begins a debate with the head of the Jews, and these debates are written in the books. I want you to go and read them in details. In details. There is no time tonight to speak about these debates. They have been recorded by scholars. They have been recorded. Go and read about them. The head of the Jews comes and he says, Ya Ali, do you want to debate with me based on the Quran? I don't agree with your Quran. I don't recognize your book. I only debate with you according to the Torah. Imam says to him, of course, and I want to debate you with you based on the Torah. The leader of the Christians, he says, I don't believe in your Quran. I believe in my Injil, my Bible. Imam says, of course, and I will debate with you according to your own Bible, your own book. Ma'mun was shaking. Ma'mun, he had a plan that Ali is going to be defeated, and when he's defeated, Shi'ism is defeated completely. We declare that because the Imamiyya, the Shi'as, they say the most knowledgeable has to be the caliph. One of the prerequisites for the Khalifa to be caliph, he has to be the most knowledgeable. So today I'm going to defeat their imam and their leader and show them that he's not the most knowledgeable. And then he encouraged those leaders, other leaders of other denominations, with gifts and money. Do your best to defeat this man. Do your best. Try to find the most difficult questions. I want to knock him down. And one after the other, in his palace, Harun had a huge palace in Khorasan. He will make the debate open, live broadcast, you know, so people, public, would come and witness, in the hope that he's going to defeat Ali ibn Musa Rida alayhi salam. And they come one after the other. And these sessions would take long hours. And the Imam standing there relaxed. He sits there and they keep asking him questions, difficult questions, and he answers from their own books. He tells the Jewish, the head rabbi of the Jewish sect, he tells him what chapter in the Torah is the answer. He mentioned the book of Genesis. Find it in the book of Genesis. And the Jewish rabbi says, wow, you know about the page? You know about my book? Book of Genesis? You read it? How do you know that? We know, my friends, this is a verse in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. The Anbiya, we teach them from us, not from outsiders. Imam alayhi salam does not have a copy of the Torah, but this is the knowledge that Allah bestows on him. وَعَلَّمْنَا, this is a verse in the Quran. عِلْمُ الَّدُنِّي. Two types of knowledge. One that we have to go to UC Irvine to study. You have to go to college. If you don't go to college, if you don't read books, you're not going to learn. Another type Allah bestows as a gift. Something like a SIM card. Allah says, come here. This is the SIM card. He puts it in their brain. This is what he does with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet Muhammad did not carry with him a pen and paper his entire life. He did not use a pen and paper. But he's a'lamun nas, the most knowledgeable person. Through whom? Through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Through revelation, through wahi. And the Prophet, before his death, he passed this knowledge and this ulum to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. And Amir al-Mu'mineen would pass it to his children, and his children to his grandchildren. Until now, the center of knowledge now in this universe is our 12th Imam, al-Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajah. So he could not defeat the Imam. And he was disappointed. So the last resort here is to get rid of the Imam. Because people after these arguments and debates, they were very impressed with Ahlul Bayt. And some of those non-Muslim leaders, history tells us, history, some of those after these debates, these series and chains of debates, they stood before the Imam, they said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So here Al-Ma'mun, he realized that he did a very foolish thing. He brought the Imam with one intention, to support his regime, to defeat the Imam, to tell the world that, see, Ahlul Bayt are bankrupt. They are not the most knowledgeable. He saw exactly the opposite happening. Allah says in the Quran, وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plan and God plans, and Allah the best of the planners. The best of the planners. So, at the end, when he realized that the Imam alayhi salam is not going to be defeated, he is becoming more popular, eyes are turning towards Al-Imam al-Ridha, and some people who were in the close circle of Al-Ma'mun, they said to him, listen, after this scandal, you know, when the Imam is defeating others, this is a scandal for you. You have to abduct the leadership and allow the Imam to be the caliph now, not after your death, now. So the pressure was mounting on Al-Ma'mun to resign. And of course, you know, as we say, as his father said, his father, Harun, he said this sentence, Al-Mulku Aqim. One day, Harun was visiting the grave of the Prophet in Medina. So his son Ma'mun said to him, oh my father, Ma'mun at that time was very young, maybe he was a teenager. He said to him, daddy, don't you think that Ahlul Bayt should assume leadership? They should assume leadership, not us. We are far from leadership. All the qualities of leadership are found in Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet. You speak about piety, they are the most pious. Knowledge, most knowledgeable. Discipline, most disciplined. Whatever you think of, whatever good quality, it is found in them. Harun said to his son Al-Ma'mun, he said to him, son, لو نازعني صاحب هذا القبر لضربت عنقه. If the one who is asleep in this grave, which is Prophet Muhammad, if he wants to fight with me over leadership, I will cut off his head. I will cut off his head. So, at the end, the leadership or Wilayatul Ahd of Imam Ridha did not last for even 2 years, less than 2 years. And Al-Ma'mun was thinking of a way, speedy way of getting rid of this Imam and securing his leadership and his Khilafah, and therefore he poisoned the Imam with some grapes. And the Imam knows, our Imams, they know what will happen to them, they know about their fate, but they surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, surrenders to Allah. And ultimately, our beloved Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salatu wassalam, he passed away in Khurasan. Let me just say one hadith before I conclude about this Imam. One of the most important hadiths that has been narrated by our eighth Imam. By the way, this Imam is very generous, very generous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants this Imam to be the gate, the Imam, Imam al-Ridha, the gate for mercy and compassion for others. So Allah will bestow, Allah does bestow some of His privileges and powers on these Imams. Some people say, why do we say Ya Imam al-Ridha? Let's say Allah. But there is a point. Sometimes Allah wants you to say Ya Imam al-Ridha. This is not shirk. Because Allah wants you to understand the importance of those imams. If you don't visit them, visitation is ziyara is haram, tawassul is haram, this is shirk, that is shirk, stay away from him. Then who's my leader? Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan? Yazid? Who's my leader? Allah wants us to know the position of those imams. Allah says to Prophet Muhammad, Allah knows that you can say Ya Allah, and He can hear you, and He listens to you. But in this book, Quran, this is Quran, chapter 4. Allah says, Ya, O Prophet, if they come to you asking for your prayers, pray for them. Allah would listen. They can go themselves. They can call upon God. God is there. God is not asleep. لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم. But God says, I want you to come to me through a certain gate. I have a gate. I want you to use the gate. And my gate are Muhammadun wa Alu Muhammad. Allah wants me and you to pay attention to the importance of the imam. So I do tawassul through him. And I realize he's important. And those are the leader of the truth. If we don't recognize the leader of the truth, definitely we're going to go into the wrong direction. As many people do today. Millions of Muslims. 900 million Muslims. They have different doctrines. They went into another direction. And Allah says in the Quran, I have one way. I want you to come to me through that way. Through the way I like, not the way you like. Come to me through that way. So the Imam says, قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, and I conclude in a few seconds. الإيمان أربعة. My friends, Iman has four branches, and all these four branches are important. They are the main pillars of Iman. Iman consists of four main pillars. Put them together, it becomes Iman. Take one of them, there is no Iman. There is no faith. The first one, التوكل على الله. The first pillar of Iman. That you have certainty with God. You put your trust in God. Have you seen some of us in our daily relationship? We trust some and we don't trust others. Why do you trust some? Sometimes you say, I can trust this person blindly. I put my full trust in him or her. Because you experience them. You experience their honesty, their integrity, their truth. So you put your trust in them. Full trust, blind trust. Imam Rida says, if you want to be with God and have faith in God, you have to have a blind trust in God. Blind trust. Blind trust means don't argue with God. Don't fight with God. If you know God is telling you in His book or the hadith of the Prophet, you must do this and you mustn't do that. You should listen here. You should not argue. Today, we had a funny thing, believe me. We had a Hajj lesson 2 hours here in that room. And we spoke about Khums. A man in his 80s, probably 85, he said, Sayyid, I read the Quran 4 times. I never found Quran speaks about Khums. 4 times. And the Quran in Surah Al-Anfal here says, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَأَنَّ لِلَّهِ خُمُسَهُ وَلِلْرَسُولِ وَلِدِ الْقَرْبِ. The guy, I don't know what, I think he read the Bible, I think so, not the Quran. Otherwise, if someone reads the Quran and he understands the Quran, it's there. Now, I wanted to say to him, if you don't want to pay, don't pay, but don't say it's not in the Quran. Don't deny, this is a crime. Sometimes we don't like something. We say, okay, I don't like it. I don't want to pray. Don't tell me about it. But don't say there is no prayers. Don't say there is no fasting. Don't say there is no Hajj. There is no zakat. Don't say this. We have to have a trust in God. Trust in God. What is Khums and zakat? You know what is Khums? We who live in America, we must believe in Khums and zakat because you pay taxes. Can you live in America without paying taxes? Can you live in Europe without paying taxes? Taxes is more important than God in America. And then Islam does not have taxes? How do you support the poor, the orphans, institutions, mosques, Quran, religion? How? Through what? Don't deny the what is embedded in the heart of the Quran. This is one. Tawakkulu ala Allah. We have to have a blind trust in God. Second, al-ridha biqada'illah. Acceptance and contentment with God, with what God has decreed for me. Al-ridha biqada'illah. Qada, sometimes God says, Mustafa, I want to take your son from you. I'm testing you. He takes my son from me. He takes my house. He takes my health. I should not complain to him. I shouldn't complain to him. At the time of tragedy, Allah says, Allah teaches me something. At the time of tragedy, say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. That's it. Don't lose yourself. Don't lose your brain. Don't lose your faith. Surrender. Qada. This is qada. Allah says, I have chosen this for you. Listen to me. I know what is good for you. I have chosen this tragedy. Al-ridha biqada'illah. Ridha, acceptance. There is nothing bigger than the murder of Imam Hussein in this universe. Imam Hussein at his murder, before his murder, when they killed his son, his baby son, he carried the son. He said, Allahumma ridhan biqada'ik. I agree with what you chose for me. I'm not complaining. I am satisfied. Ridha, ridha, content. We, the weak-spirited, we always complain to God. Why did he do this to me? Why I am in this situation? Why I am this? Why I am that? We should accept when it happens, it happens. One day, Imam al-Sadiq had a baby son, who was very sick. And he was sitting with the group of companions, so he would go inside, indoors, where the women's family section is. And then he comes back, and then he goes, and he comes back. The companions, they realize that there is something wrong. Every 5 minutes, the imam goes, and he comes back, and he goes. And then the imam came after that, and he sat with them, and he started talking to them. They said to him, what is it, Ya Ibn Rasulullah? We saw you being agitated. Something wrong? He said, yes, we had a newly born baby. He was sick. And the baby was sick. When he was sick, I was going and coming back to check on him. Last time I went, he died. So I surrendered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I said, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Now I come back and he started talking to them. Al-ridha biqada'illah. Tragedies happen in our life, we have to accept them. We should not complain. If you don't complain, you go on the highway sooner, faster, closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a test. It's a test. But if you complain, you're going to go into the opposite direction. Opposite direction. Al-ridha biqada'illah. This is the second. And the third, Imam al-Ridha says, At-taslimu li amrillah. Taslim. Taslim means when Allah surrenderance. But this is different than al-ridha. Al-ridha biqada'illah when it happens. When a tragedy strikes, you have to accept. But this is before it strikes. Allah says to you, I want you to do certain things, and it is difficult for you to do. Allah said to Ibrahim, what did he say to him? قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ. Oh my son, little son, only son, 12 years old son. I saw in my dream, and the dream is the truth and reality, this is an order of God, that I am slaying you. So what do you think I should say? Immediately the son said to him, Daddy, if you have seen this in the dream, you have to do it today. Don't ask me. Why do you ask me? قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ فَعَلْ. Immediately do what you have been asked to do by God. افعل ما تؤمر. And I promise you, ستجدني إن شاء الله من الصابرين. With the will of God, I will bear this. Put the knife on my neck and sacrifice me. I'm not going to say no. You have to do it today. Today. This is the commands of God. What are you waiting for? This is taslim. Now Allah is asking us not to kill our sons. Did He ask you to kill your son? Did He ask you to kill the chicken in your backyard? Allah said 5 daily prayers, fasting the month of Ramadan, Hajj only once in a lifetime, your zakat if you have money. Be good to your parents, be good to your family, be good father, be a good mother, be a good neighbor. This is what He's asking us. And all of these are good for us. Don't drink wine. You see the wine, you go to a wedding, you go to a party, people are drinking. Resist, don't drink, don't eat something haram. When you know this is an act of theft, stay away from it. When you know this is an act of a fraud, stay away from it. These are the tests. Allah did not ask us to kill ourselves or our children. These are small tests. But still we refuse. Still people, they refuse. She came to us one day and she said that my husband is putting pressure on me to take off my hijab. And I took my hijab. I said to her, but if your husband puts pressure on you to drink this poison, would you do it? Huh? You don't. You tell him you are crazy. Leave me alone. You tell him, this is America. I'm free. Leave me alone. So when he puts pressure on you to take off your hijab, you listen to him. You don't listen to the Lord. Who's your husband? He could be today your husband. Tomorrow he could be stranger. He divorces you. You have to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taslim. Taslim is to surrender to what He wants from us. We have to do that. And then the fourth one, وَالتَّفْوِيضُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَصِيرٌ بِلَهِ. You face a problem in your life. You do whatever you can. You do. You have to defend yourself. But sometimes there are certain things you reach here, a limit that you can't do anything. Whether it is a sickness, whether it's a court appearance, whether it's a disagreement with a neighbor, with a wife, with a son, with people, with this, what you try to defend yourself. Do your homework and leave the rest with Allah. Do your share and leave the next, the other share with Allah. وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. That's the best dua. At the time of severe tests, trials and tribulations that we all go through. We all go through them. Say this always. وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. My file is with him. He's the attorney. He's my attorney. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. These are the four pillars of faith. Imam al-Ridha says, الْإِيمَانُ عَلَىٰ أَرْبَعَةٍ التَّوَكُّلُ عَلَىٰ اللَّهِ وَالْرِضَى بِقَضَاءِ اللَّهِ وَالتَّسْلِيمُ إِلَىٰ اللَّهِ وتفويض الأمر إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات. Before I conclude, we have نشيد and مدحين إن شاء الله. But many people asked me to pray for them. This is a happy occasion of the Milad of our 8th Imam, Imam Ar-Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam. Just let's recite this ayah together. Yeah, many of them are in our community, in our masjid, they are sick. Some of them are really suffering. So let's raise our hands بحق الإمام الرضا عليه الصلاة والسلام and pray to Allah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 يا الله من على مرضانا بالشفاء والعافية المرضى المنظورين اللهم ألبسهم ثوب الصحة والعافية وعجل في فرج سيدنا ومولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والشهداء وإلى روح الإمام الرضا صلوات الله وسلامه عليه ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.